Welcome to our presentation. My name is Manuel Stoiber. I'm a research scientist at the German Aerospace Center and a PhD student at the Technical University of Munich. Today, I'm happy to introduce you to our paper, A Sparse Gaussian Approach to Region-Based 6-Degree of Freedom Object Tracking. The work was created together with my advisors, Aline and Rudolf, and my colleagues, Klaus and Martin. The general goal of 6-degree of freedom object tracking is to estimate both the rotation and translation of an object relative to the camera from consecutive images. For region-based tracking, we use image statistics to differentiate between a foreground region that corresponds to the object and a background region. As image statistics, we typically use color histograms, one for the foreground and one for the background. Based on those histograms, we are able to estimate the probability that the pixel belongs to the foreground or to the background. An example of this is shown in the image on the right. Typically, state-of-the-art methods then use a 3D model of the object, and based on the current pose of this 3D model, they calculate a theoretical probability that the pixel belongs to the foreground or to the background. They then combine this theoretical probability that depends on the object pose with the actual probability from the image to form a likelihood function. By maximizing this likelihood function, one is then able to estimate the pose that best explains the image. Unfortunately, this optimization process is quite computationally expensive, since for each iteration of the optimization, one has to render the 3D model into the image, calculate a signed distance function, and based on the distance of a pixel to the contour of the object, assign a theoretical probability to that pixel. That's why we would like to propose a highly efficient, sparse approach to region-based tracking. To avoid the rendering step, we use a sparse model that consists of contour points and normal vectors that are pre-computed for multiple views all around the object. Also, we provide a probabilistic formulation that considers image information sparsely along so-called correspondence lines. An example of correspondence lines is shown in the image on the right as orange lines. Since the contour of an object is locally very similar, we typically do not lose information by significantly improving efficiency. A correspondence line is defined by a center C and a normal vector N. Both are calculated by projecting a 3D contour point and normal vector from the closest view of our sparse model into the image. Instead of calculating a signed distance function over the entire image, we simply use the projected distance delta C that points from the correspondence line center C to a variated 3D contour point that is projected into the image. We then introduce this projected distance delta C into smoothed step functions to model the theoretical probability that the pixel belongs to the foreground or to the background. We then again combine these theoretical probabilities with the actual probabilities from our image to form a likelihood function for each correspondence line. For the likelihood function, we consider multiple pixels along the correspondence line. A pixel is thereby described by the value r that points from the correspondence line center to the center of a pixel. The nice thing about our likelihood function is that we can prove mathematically that for particular smooth step functions hf and hb, this likelihood function actually follows a normal distribution. This means that for particular projected distances, delta c, that shift our smooth step functions, we get a probability value that lies on a normal distribution. For our probabilistic model, we also provide a discrete scale space formulation that considers correspondence lines at multiple scales. An example of this is shown in the video on the right. Also, we project from the continuous space along the correspondence line into a discrete space for which we can pre-calculate values for our smooth step functions. For the maximization of our likelihood function, we use Newton optimization with Dekunov regularization. As you can see in the equation, we use different regularization parameters for the rotation and for the translation. Since Newton optimization is a second-order optimization scheme, we have to provide both first-order derivatives in form of a gradient vector and second-order derivatives in form of a Hessian matrix. To calculate robust first and second-order derivatives, we use an approximation of our likelihood function. For this, we calculate probability values for multiple projected distances, delta c, at discrete values. We then use our knowledge that the likelihood function follows a normal distribution and approximate those probability values with a normal distribution. For the calculation of first-order derivatives, we differentiate between two cases. If the two closest probability values are above a certain threshold, those two values are used in the calculation of the first-order derivative. If one of the values is below this threshold, we unfortunately cannot guarantee that the value is heavily affected by noise. In such cases, it might even be possible that the first-order derivative might point in the wrong direction. In those cases, we then use the approximated normal distribution in the calculation of the first-order derivative. For the second-order derivative, which is much more affected by noise, we always use the approximated normal distribution to calculate those second-order derivatives. As a result of those approximations, our algorithm becomes much more robust to image noise and to wrongly classified pixels. To compare our approach to the current state of the art, we did an evaluation on the region-based object tracking dataset. The dataset features 18 objects and 5 sequences, for example, with dynamic light, noise, and occlusions. We can show that our approach outperforms the current state of the art for almost all objects, performing on average about 7 to 8 percentage points better in terms of tracking success. In addition, our algorithm runs more than one order of magnitude faster than the current state of the art. This is even more impressive since our approach only utilizes a single CPU core, while the competition heavily depends on a GPU, and most of the algorithms also implement multithreading. For our evaluation, we also did multiple experiments in the real world. As you can see in this video, our approach is quite robust to unmodeled occlusions. Also, we provide occlusion modeling using an occlusion mask and disabling correspondence lines for which the center falls on this occlusion mask. Using this occlusion modeling, we are able to robustly track objects even if they are almost completely occluded, as you can see in this sequence. In the following sequence, we want to show very fast camera motion. And as you can see here, although we are quite at the limit here, we are nicely tracking this mug object. And finally, in this sequence, we want to show the tracking of a text marker pen while using it. And as you can see here, although we are of course occluding the object by holding it, we are nicely tracking this small object. In summary, the essential aspects of our algorithm are a sparse formulation that features correspondence lines, a likelihood function for which we can prove mathematically that it follows a Gaussian distribution, a highly efficient discrete scale space formulation that considers correspondence lines at multiple scales, and robust approximations for first and second order derivatives that are used in a Newton optimization with Tikhonov regularization. In conclusion, this gives us an approach that performs significantly better than the current state of the art in terms of tracking success while being more than one order of magnitude faster. For more details, please check the paper and also our source code, which we made publicly available. Thank you very much for listening.